really the interesting topic theme there, and in between the break or some are discussing, and the question for all the answers we find in that subtitle. One of the student is sharing his experience, which is very nice. Now from this we go to another important last heading of the second chapter, namely eschatology and impact on life and action. The rediscovery of this eschatological approach should have vital consequences for Christian life and action. The rediscovery of the eschatological approach should have the vital consequences. Should be elaborately discussed. Vital consequences of Christian life and action. That's why I said it's concerned about the life, I said. And I showed two titles of the book of how they put life, their eternal life, towards the end. And now if you remember that, you can understand it more easier. It should be rekindled, that sense of dedication to progress and renewal that is endemic in Christianity as religion. In other words, rekindle the sense of dedication and progress renewal. What in the, all the words, the life is there, but I did not put the word there. Dedication and progress and renewal. But only thing is, if you put on this one, simple spirituality, very nice, we heard, our patron said, our Father Francis said, all this said. No doubt in that. But in Telugu, we have one joke, one saying, no? In other words, our tree is good, so eat the fruit. No, let them see the fruit. Tree is good, whether it bear the good fruit or not, we don't know. Good tree also can bear bad fruit sometimes, no? Or in between will be rotten if you are not taking care of that. So, Marxists have zeal and enthusiasm because they are convinced that history is moving towards the fulfillment. And here, dear brothers, this life and action, dedication, progress and renewal. Now I use my examples. For example, Marxists, Karl Marx. Though born in Germany, but he went to Switzerland or Russia and implemented his Marxism, socialism there. So they have a zeal and enthusiasm for what? That moving towards the fulfillment of life. We are going to have equality, we are going to have goods distributed for everybody equally, and we enjoy all that. They say that one there, okay? But Christians should have much more remembering that God's intervention or action works through them. It is not your own action brings the equality. You as a believer, believe, have hope, that one there. So Christians should have much more remembering God's intervention in this history there, or action works through them. It should give a future-oriented approach toward mankind is striving after the new in everything. So, future orientation and serving after the new, that everything become good to new. That's why he uses that word, renewal, renew. Now, the men of this era are attracted, fascinated only by the future. That is, by that which has never been. Hence, the Soren Kierkegaard says, passion for the possible. Yeah, I quoted some of the bits, J.B. Metz and so on. So, Christians are fascinated by the future. And who are the Christians, especially those who are sitting here, also fascinated by? Future. What? I want to receive that? Ordination, Radha says. Future, all are worried about that only. No? Our poor deacons are waiting desperately the last 1 year. And we are fixing the date and going. Because of the corona, we cannot go for head. But now our bishop decided to give that one. No doubt in that. Now what I want to say is, that not only the future, enjoy the present, live it meaningfully. That's what I want to say. So eschatology provides a balance, that's excessive existentialism that threatens to deny the value of both the past and the future in religion. That is very interesting. Eschatology balance, positive balance. Otherwise, existential Lord say, now this present moment is important, where you are existing. Understand? This, that, no, that's existential. No, that is not correct. It's the value of the both past and the future in religion is important. So, Bultmann says here, this is called a realized eschatology. He uses another word here. In Bultmann's realized eschatology, what matters is man's present commitment, decision, moment, based on kerygma or the preached word. This present decision for God's, for God represents God's eschatological inbreak. So here he uses very big words there. What is that? Man's present commitment to this, what we have heard, and based on the kerygma. What is kerygma? Preaching of the early fathers or apostles, after later kerygma. So, or the preached word which they preached there, and the permanent commitment can be based on a true eschatological approach there. So he explains there, because he's a New Testament scholar, he takes the message accurately, concretely, and explains how this eschatology is explained there. Yet a permanent commitment can be based on the true eschatological approach. There's a gradual realization of God's kingdom by the risen Christ through the power of his spirit. In other words, this eschatological reign has been inaugurated and also invited by him, that you and me can also take part. But only look at, enjoy the present and think of the past and future. So time factor is very much involved in that there. Because the next part also I will be explaining that at least half of the chapter, how this time, then how this is connected to the eschaton and kairos, kairoi, all these explain terms and explanation, how this progress, will be dealing you little more detail. So kindly read these two chapters, and if you have any doubts, you can ask even before class and after tomorrow, and kindly spend some time, because you can follow better, as you know. It may be a sentence, may be little tough, you may not understand so on, but if you present yourself there when you are reading, surely you will understand there. So first day is a fruitful day. Yes or no?
Yes, Father.
Very good. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us together. Eschatology, then a creative eschatology, and here our main effort is impact life after death. In other words, that the impacts on life and in the action. Now from here, from this general solid foundation to the course, we move to the scriptural side, because any teaching in theology should be supported by the scripture, not for supporting sake, should be proved, explained by the scripture. So we move to the third chapter, namely eschatology in the Old Testament. But suddenly, if I start, this is eschatology, Old Testament, this, and you may not be able to understand. We have to put again the foundational basis and foundation for this. How Old Testament, there is eschatology in the Old Testament. Yeah. How eschatology is explained in the Old Testament. Christian eschatology presupposes Jewish eschatology and grows out of it. So it's very simple. So Christian eschatology or Christianity grew as a child from the Jewish religion, no doubt in that. But even the eschatology also presupposes the Jewish eschatology and grows out of it. So that is a very interesting and very foundation for Christian eschatology seen. Only a detailed analysis of their respective origins and nature, therefore, will enable us to discern lines of continuity and points of difference between the two, namely Christian and Jewish eschatology. Beginning with the Old Testament, we will trace the origin of the Jewish full-blown eschatological thinking of it. Thinking of the post-exilic era. You know, in the Old Testament, exile, exilic era, and post-exilic era. Back to its roots in the earliest strata of the biblical tradition. So here, if you see that in the our slides, the Christian hope is rooted in the Old Testament. That is clear. Now, Christians are people of hope, as Paul says again and again in his letters. Christians are the people filled with hope. It will be fulfilled in their lifespan, and they had hope for it, and they had to live in that hope. We hope when everything in our life leads us to despair. Christian hope is based on what God has done in and through His Son Jesus Christ, who is the culmination and the climax of the history of Israel. So, we cannot understand the Christian hope unless, until we go back to consider hope in Old Testament. So, because our hope in Jesus Christ is the culmination of what God has done in the history of Israel. So, yesterday we have seen human history, salvation history. How? And the salvation history, how that it is ended in the person of Christ or takes its climax there. So here if you see that Christians are people of hope, and Christian hope is the base for the Christian people of hope, and also Old Testament, and based on what has God done through Jesus Christ. So a person is cutting the history there. So that is Jesus Christ. He is the culmination and climax of the history of Israel. So that is Jewish history, and now Christian history, or life with Christ, starts there from Jewish. It is not mere historical strata. It is not mere prophetical literature. It is the real and the true history manifested, manifolded, and magnanimously shown. And now you have to understand, or we are being invited to grasp this. Namely, if it is this history with this person, now in the history always one thing is important, some very important. What is that? For example, now what is important for us?
Revelation.
And where it's happened? It's happened in the sky, on the sky or on the earth? Where?
God's
in a particular
in
particular time. That is important. In a particular time, it happens there. So, dear students, we go 3.1 shift from cyclical to the linear conception of time. In most of his books, but especially in his book Cosmos and History, The Myth of the Eternal Return, the influential philosopher of the ancient religion of the mythical thought, Mircea Eliade, discovers that what predominates in all cosmic, mythological, lunar conception is the cyclical recurrent of what has been before, in a word, eternal return. So, in his book Cosmos and History, or the Myth of the History, Eternal Return, Eliade describes about this linear or lunar and cycle system of time. He explained there. So, here if you see, what says this in a word, eternal return. In other words, return to the eternity, or in your understand, going to have a share in the eternal life. Again, I said yesterday to the two books by Ratzinger and Professor Gerhard Loefing, that eternal life. Why they are so much concerned about this life, eternal life? Because from there we came, there we supposed to go, and we have been given options to go for that life. We have given ample of freedom to opt for life, that life. Now, here everything begins over again at its commencement every instant. The past is but the prefiguration of the future. Now, yesterday, it had been bored for you all the time, this time, past, future, present. And now, we have to understand, we have to take into consideration that element, that interrelatedness of these three consecutive timings. That's why today we put a step ahead. There is a past is nothing. Past is but a prefiguration of the future. So prefiguration of the future. No event is irreversible, and no transformation is final. In a certain sense, it is even possible to say that nothing new happens in the world, for everything is but the repetition of the same primordial archetypes. So primordial archetype, a type is existing. Primordial archetype, that the ancient archetype, namely, as opposed to this, by observing the events through which God intervenes in Israel's favor, the prophets realized that such event is new, unique, different from all others. Therefore, this is unrepeatable, that event, that time factor. Yeah. And if you see, thus it's a, one is past prefiguration, a primordial archetype with the timing, and opposed to the prophets realized that each event is new and unique and irrepeatable. So if it is repeatable, I can wait, I can hope that this lecture may be repeatable if the people cannot understand. But at times it's irrepeatable, as we are bounded with the technique, as we are bounded with the time and space. So Eliade describes Hebrews were the first to discover the meaning of history as the epiphany of God, as the manifestation of God in history. The Hebrew flock have that rediscovered that there. Now, cultural change is complex and normally slow, because it is today what you think, your dress code, or how you listen these lectures in this online or YouTube, it is unimaginable. But it is a substitute to have that knowledge, to acquire the knowledge. And that's why the church or the media or our institute offers this chance for us. So it is a culture, technological culture, but without losing the essence, without losing the existence. Both are important. So here, if we see that Eliade concludes, it may be said that with the truth that the Hebrews are the first people to discover the history and epiphany, and this is the conception, as we should expect, was taken up and amplified by the Christianity. So Christianity took that and has been amplified, multiplied, explained, or can be, we can also say, a simplified person to person there. Because Christianity concerned the personal growth, personal commitment of a person to the person of Christ, to the instrumentality of the church or an institution like this. In all cultural change is complex and normally slow. We can expect the transition from, say, cyclic model of time to the linear model to be highly complex and gradual. So here, please pay a little more attention. Cyclic model, so it is a rotates, it comes there. From that time, the lunar, a linear model, a line is there, which is rather complex to be highly complex and gradual in comparison with the cyclic model. Because if I said the cyclic system comes, when students were less, previously we used to have class cyclic system, as you know. Because you can have more strength and also knowledge, and also the professors also need not be repeated there. But now, thank God, we have enough students to listen and also enough professors also to teach. That one there, that is important. For example, we had only just 5 professors in our theology. Only 1-2 doctorates and some 2 licenses and so on. So at least nearly some 15 years the regional seminary struggled in Hyderabad. But thank God, now they had enough professors, and now students may be a little less, but is sharing the knowledge. So they are hoping, and it's developing there. It's also being challenged, the ministry of teaching. Now, back to our this, it would be a mistake to think that Israel had to formulate the new idea before it could build its own eschatology in it. Understand that sentence? Formulate the new idea before it built its own eschatology on it. Now, the two things happen at the same time. What are they? It is only when a protology and an eschatology are sufficient formed, that is, when the notion of creation of the cosmos, of an end of history, have been basically clarified, that time can be convinced as life. So now this cycle, this line. Now here we see the geometry teaches us that the straight line is the shorter than the distance between the two points. As soon as the two points emerge, also line connecting them emerges. This is how R. Lautrelle describes the two conceptions of time. In other words, you see that line. So if I start first here, and it's the beginning there, and as it goes near this one there, so it touches there. So the pinpointing of that one there, at a point they meet there, where they start, they meet there, they go and they meet there. That's what this sentence is. The straight line is shorter distance between the two points there. So the straight line is going, but the shorter this distance, this, because if it moves, it is shorter. If it moves, it's shorter. You follow? Now that's what here it says there. Now from here, that is a general conception, or what do you say, a shift of cycle to the linear conception type, generally based on the Hebrews. Now we go the conception of time outside Israel. Outside the Israel people there. Outside Israel, there is no firmly established idea of a continuous succession of temporal events embracing the past, present and future, all upholding according to the direction and towards a goal there. So I have a goal, then automatically I march, I go. Now you have a goal, come to Vijnanalayam, but unfortunately you are not allowed from your house to go out, because you have to take care of yourself. Corona teaches us how people can grow in self-responsibility and self-taking care there. Okay, can't but situation, you have to go and out. But you and me, the students, fortunate to have this, say, big houses, big halls, big rooms. But you need to have big heart to accept them, and it also expected from us to be a responsible person in knowing. Now, among the ancient polytheistic peoples, what is polytheism? Monotheism? Many gods. People, attention is directed first to all nature. Attentive a rhythm of stars, seasons, rhythms. In other words, if you see here, the conception of time, idea of the confusion and succession. That's the temporal events, past, present, future. That is clear, the masters are discussing. Now, ancient polytheistic peoples are in attention to the nature, how it's there. And rhythm of the stars and the seasons. birth and death. Yes. Simple. In one's life, it happens there. Now here, religions of India, ancient religions, Buddhism, Jainism, and also on Hinduism, and in China and Persianism, they centered only on a wisdom rather than an history there. So they centered rather than the history there. Now here, if you see, what is really important is to be delivered from cosmos time, cosmic time, by transcending it. Now, time for the Indians is measured, but it has not a center. It is barren. It comes there. Yogam calls it epo. And now they say 10th this one Kali Yugam. Kali Yugam lo anni kashtalu, that all the difficulties will come, they say. Now if you ask why rivers are swimming, why this natural calamities, why this corona, Kali Yugam, that you are losing the human nature, and humanity is becoming a barren humanity for the values and the virtues. No interest to possess them, no interest to live and also show. And that is a challenging factor. Now we are facing. That's why there are three planes: individual time, cosmic time, and outside time. Here, a time for the Indians is measured, but it has not center. It is a barren. Hellenism, in its general aspects, is trapped with a cyclic conception of things. Aliens, who are they? Hellenism.
Hellenists.
Greeks. Wisdom. They are all very concentrated in that. Everything comes from wisdom. And the Greek concept of time is one of the despair, without origin. So they have no center, these people have no origin. Without any privileged moment, without meaning, without any bond with freedom and human salvation. So history as it is conceived by Herodotus and Theodulus has a movement, not a teleology. So teleology, about this one telescope they call it now. Even the smallest one they want to see, they want to show. That's why, but that chuchana darjam chuchana darsam, this one. Okay, now not sukshma. Sukshma. Yeah, that's the smallest. That's where when you go to planetariums and so on, especially in Birla Paratama, we used to visit when students in Hyderabad. So there is something like that. Sir, telescope is fixed there, and if you put rupee coin or something only, then it opens, then slowly it ever, then we can see that one there. But you become slave of that instrument. But you should have that in your heart and mind. That is important here. So, as the gods captive and the individual must escape from time. Salvation for the Greek could never be the result of an historical event. They don't want to accept that one there. So, now from this outside, they have different, depends on the stars' nature more, or the wisdom. And before that, there depends on the starting God. Now, from this, our main concern is how this time is explained out in Israel. First, we have said outside Israel, now in Israel. Israel's history as the salvation history. Namely, Israel was the first to break the fatal circle of season and repetitions in which the ancient world has so enclosed. They became enslaved, the ancient world. Now, it's Israel came and broke away that one. Then. That one break the this fatal, that layers are individuals. Now, it broke with change, that is only perpetual new beginning. So now we have to pay attention that perpetual new beginning is going to take place now. in the span, space of history, that's the time. Salvation is accomplished in temporal history. It is bound up with a succession of events unfolding according to the divine plan, leading towards one unique fact or one unique historical event. What is that? Christ event. Passion, death, and that one. So now in that time factor, event, historical event is taking place in that time there. That's why we see Exodus 14 chapter or 12 chapter, that's Passover. Exact month, the time is described there. And same thing, Johannine literature, that is the 13th chapter, you also. Evening came, all he gathered his disciples in the room.
In the upper room.
Upper room is a symbol of togetherness, God and man. But God and man meets there, but that meeting point is important, but that meeting moments has to be cherished. That's why he says, as a master, as a teacher, I am doing the service of washing. Now you do this. And yes, this breaking the bread, but break yourself. In other words, carry this message. Be a messenger of that love and service. That's what explained there. And now, only once in a year we read that. But it is an important event there. That's why this historical event, Old and the New Testament explained there. Now, the death and resurrection of, the unique fact is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Where does the cyclic conception of time come from, and how did Israel manage to break out of it there? From where that is come there? Experts agree that the former is based on the cycles of nature, day, night, and four seasons, and the annual rotation of the stars, then birth and death. Everything in nature is cyclic and suggests a round conception of time. So it is taking there and suggests that annual rotation of the stars, both death and resurrection, and suggests a round conception of time. If Israel managed to break out of this fractal circle, please pay attention to this sentence. If the Israel managed to break this fractal circle, it is only because of the divine revelation, not by itself. Divine revelation has occurred, taken place in this. A revelation which contemporary theology conceives as existentially historical, in a historical fact. Are you following?
Yes, sir.
So while the religion of surrounding peoples was based on a nature, so Israel could able to break because of God's intervention in the history. That is a spiritual language, biblical traditional language that you have been listening and you have been pondering over there. But now we have to adapt to the theology. While the religion surrounding peoples as based on nature, while the gods of these religions were nature gods, connected with rain and fertility, okay, and growth of crops, herds, and people. So it is connected with nature, history, nature. Now we are putting. Whereas before that, culture, nature, but now history and nature. Yahweh, or God the Father, God of Israel, was a God of history because he was a God of people. He was a God of people. He attracted himself to one nation, loved it, and fondly cared for it, and led it to the goal assigned by him through the series of salvific interventions in the course of the history. So this God is a personal God to the personal people, but it is a nation. So nation concept, this one personhood, go to the nationhood or nationality, so to say. And this nationality is the compromises are consists of all the people there. That's why it's a salvific intervention of salvific intervention in the course of the history where God entered for all the people. We are familiar with this set of ideas, no doubt. What is more difficult to grasp is the connection between an historical revelation and linear conception of time. Because linear conception goes, historical revelation enters there. Now, Gerhard von Rad suggests that between two a third term should be inserted, namely liturgy. So this, to explain this, how this historical revelation, how this linear conception of time here explains the liturgy, a worship, a prayer. It is the annual celebration of the salvific events in the tribal shrines that kept their memory alive and gradually led to the conception of a single line connecting to all the single divine plan upholding in time. So liturgy is being given emphasis and explanation for this meeting point of these two. And now we just completed that Israel's history, how it turned to be salvation history. Now, before we proceed, we have a short break, then we come back. Okay. The process of the oral tradition and theological reflection. So there are three points here, let us note, namely the salvific event happens in the secular world. So it is also a global and yes, articulate way as God's deed, in other words, sacred. So second one, the event and the religious experience varies the tribal shrines in different ways, different places. Third, repeated liturgical celebration traditions sets up this and makes it little more articulate. And the result of the repeated liturgical celebration tradition sets, the fact is that the event is celebrated in a number of tribal shrines surrounded by different religious, social, historical. Social, historical and religious circumstance gives rise to the variety of traditions. So in the liturgy, yes, we know traditions are important. So we have seen in the first years, second year, Eastern tradition, Western tradition there, how this liturgy developed. And Eastern tradition, they give more importance to the liturgy, Western also, but iconography and scripture, spirituality is much more emphasized in the Eastern scripture. And here, if you see, there are four sources of JPD, that is one of the traditions there. It is this redactional work that brings into a single national calendar. This work, this was brought all this religious, secular and historical brought in single work. That's a national calendar. The liturgical festival celebrated in separate tribal shrines. At this stage, we notice a particular phenomena, that is namely harmonization of the cycle and line. So till now there are two different cycle system, linear. Now this JPD, that reduction work, put them together there. In this new setup, the cycle survives in the form of a recurrent yearly liturgical calendar. So now we are giving the connection to the our history, which is celebrated in the liturgy. I mean salvation history. However, this yearly cycle is no longer based on nature as before, or seasons, the next, but it is on history. So no nature, no culture, and no season, but based on the history. Instead of covering only one year, it covers entire length of the Israel's history. If it is only 1 year covers, that it's not only the limited that, but it covers the whole history. The religious festivals may coincide with the seasonal festival of nomadic shepherds and settled agriculturists, but they have been harmonized Eastern, harmonized. Namely, now I'm coming from the history, Salvation history, Israel history, now coming to the present context there. Namely, these two festivals mark this history. Easter is a pastoral festival, defeating desert, that is theological, meaning no doubt in that. But coming to the new life there, Easter festival, pastoral. And second is Pentecost, agriculture feast, fruit.
Harvest.
That's why Penta is?
Fifty.
So after 50 days of Easter we celebrate. So pastoral festival and agricultural feast. Now from here we move to another important reason, Kairos. Now this is connected to our, what is that called, eschatology. Kairos. Israel's conception of time as linear differs not only from the ancient cultures but also from the modern scientific view. Modern scientific teleology, teleology, all that. So what prevails today is the idea of time as an ideal line that can be divided and subdivided. So this idea of time is a linear, and idea of time, epochs, millennia, centuries, years, months, days, okay, then hours, seconds, and so on. So time is, the idea of time is there. So time is identical with the events of the salvation history. Now I am giving the, how they are interconnected. Yeah, somebody asked me how it is connected to the salvation history. Now it is there. So the plan of God unfolds in history. Now slowly we are coming to the theological interpretation. Now redemptive history is the scheme, not human deliberation but divine decision. That point is very much important for me here, by this one there. So plan of God unfolds in the history, that's the history, that's clear. Redemptive history is the same, but not the human deliberation but the divine decision. That means God himself takes the decision to be one and to save this mankind who needs salvation, who needs redemption, liberation. Now, as part of this, you and me can better understand, but turn back to the ages there, that time. First, a shock for them. That's why they have not accepted this one. Are not his brothers and sisters with us? Can any good come from out of Nazareth? And also, is he not a carpenter's son? From where did he get this? And go and do the miracles in Galilee, then we believe. And show the power, show the sign that we believe that you are the son of God. And can you not hinder your friend from death, Lazarus? All these statements. This explains there. So, Kairoi, this is chosen one of God. In other words, in Israel, time is identical with the events of the history of the salvation. Okay? The plan of God unfolds in history due solely to his great salvific and revelationary intervention. So he is intervening with the human history. Understand? And that human history is turned to be salvation history. How? There should be something. Namely, Kairoi, that constitute the very fabric of time. The fabric of time is Kairoi. But that is a time and Kairoi, that crucial and minute or moment. Now, O. Pullman, who has popularized Israel's linear conception of time in his influential book, Christ and Time, has this to say about the biblical conception of Kairos. Kairoi is the time in Israel. Kairos uses there. Kairos in secular usage is the moment in which is the time, is moment in time which is especially favorable for undertaking. The Kairoi and Kairoi. It's a Kairo, from Kairoi, Kairoi comes, then it turned to be Kairos person. So namely, that moment of time which is a favorable to undertaking of something. What is that? The New Testament is usage with reference to the redemptive history. Redemptive history is the same. History, salvation history, redemptive history, and redeemer. Kairoi, Kairos, Kairoi, and Kairoi, and Kairos. Now we are coming to that. Here, however, it is not the human deliberation but the divine decision that makes this, that date a Kairos, a point of time that has a special place in the execution of God's plan of salvation. The Kairos execute that special moment, enters the human history, changes this history, and it turns there and becomes a crucial point of belief. Now, because the realization of the divine plan of salvation is bound to such time points, or that point which breaks, it enters, or Kairoi, that is the chosen by God. That moment is chosen by God. That is a moment, anything. But that person chosen by God. Now we are coming to that person. The time becomes the first day. Therefore, it is a redemptive history, still that event. Okay? Not all fragments of ongoing time constitute redemptive history in the narrower sense, but rather the specific points, this Kairoi is singled out from time as a whole. Hello, one point enters there, changes there, and this becomes whole, universal, Kairoi. This Kairos or Kairoi is being used by the Old Testament prophets. And there we see a little more. Namely, once the Pentateuch is full, constituted, it is the prophets, then apocalyptic writers that carry the Jewish conception of time to its completion. That's why I saw Son of Man sitting on the throne. I saw Son of Man ruling the 12 tribes. Son of Man, get up, go on, prophesy that dry bones live, apocalypse. But the three young men saw in the furnace of fire, praying, Daniel. And whom did he see under the tree? Yes, that woman and that man is there. Under which tree? Then they separated. That man sat under the tree, this man under the tree. Then Daniel said, immediately snatch them, first kill them and save that woman. The time of her. Suppose if he is not intervened, God in the form of this man, the innocent woman might have been gone, condemned to death. So their intervention of God. So God's Kairoi are confined to the past. Then with the prophets, they are extended into the present and the future. Now I am bringing back again there, time, how this Kairoi is in the time there. Now, here, that from the eschatological point of view, contemporary events are read and interpreted in occurring according to God's plan. The contemporary events that are taking place there are interpreted as God's plan. Now the same plan that had already started upholding at creation and in the earlier constitutive phases of Israel's history. Now that plan of God intervened in the Israel's history. From the eschatological point of view, however, it has to wait until the exile for a crucial breakthrough to take place. That break is taking place there, entering there, and taking their point there. However, one has to wait until the exile for the crucial breakthrough to take place. It is especially at this crucial critical juncture that Israel's faith can turn not only to the immediate future foreseen by prophecy, but to the ultimate future of eschatology. Now the crisis of the exile seems to frustrate God's promises future posterity because the children of Abraham. In other words, prophets carry this Jewish concept of time and confront the past and extend to the future and extend into the God's present, that is a kairoi. Their present moment is kairoi. Now, eschatological point of view to wait until that exile. Now, I am coming from the salvation history to the exilic period there. You know, you have finished there, that exile period in the scriptures there. Now, ultimate future of eschatology is this crisis of the exile being heard by God. That's why day first we had Ezekiel, he was asked, prophesy that no, your wife is going to die this evening, but you should not be sad, you should not remove your turban, you should not eat the morning bread, you should be happy. I prophesied morning and evening my wife died. Next day I did as God said. So are you taking pleasure in the persons or the possessions? In the gospel, the rich young man asking there, good teacher there. So I put that way, you are taking pleasure in the persons, who? The wife of Ezekiel or the possessions as a rich man, but where? That you may say, seminarians, what possessions? We don't have money to buy even the stationery, we don't have money to recharge the telephone also. You may say that mobile, though not allowed, but some recharge it. This one. Corona time, seminaries became very hard, very good it seems, especially the Dyson seminarians. How? What they did in the Corona time, do you know?
So many creativities.
Huh? Creativities. Yet this religious may do the Dyson, though I am a Dyson, I see the truth. No. Huh?
Working.
They did a very good thing, dear brothers.
Working.
Both. So big people are there, not so holy people are not there. Composing songs, writing songs, reading books, that is gone. They went for work.
Yes, sir.
And earned the money. Earned the money, pocket money. Most of them. That's why I was trying to get some brothers for my house guarding because I don't have minus in this. And nobody is coming. One fellow I brought and he was there 2 weeks. Father, when I will go back, when I will go, he was asking. When I gave him also, the money is 2000 rupees for 2-3 weeks. But still, I respect that idea of working and yearning. But for what you are doing that yearning, this is my question. Are you buying only your whims and fancies and recharging mobile which is not allowed to use? At that. That's what we should know that there. So from the exile period, post-exile period, they have experienced that something there. That's what. As a religious, you have no other chance. Either remain in the community or go home and get affected by corona. So most of you remain here, at least some of you. The poor OCD brothers, you can see the whole campus, they painted. Whole building, they painted. The OCD brothers. But I like them that they are able to do something for their house. And SCC brothers, the whole higher summer, they are only taking care of their garden. And I am also there only in my garden only doing this. But corona taught us self-respect and work and earn what you want there. Okay, now why I said that example is because of this, namely that the crisis of the exile or crisis of this period, the children of Abraham are scattered there, that time, there. Salvation history, then exile and post-exilic period. And what that called apocalyptic literature. Now, the exile time, the land is lost, the temple is destroyed, and future hopes are shattered. And now, at this turmoil, disappointment, in the exilic years, prophet comes and explains there the end in God's own absolute future, namely, eschatology is born. You have hope in your God who intervened in your life there. So at the prophet's help, as the prophets help Israel to understand and believe what God has promised cannot fail to happen. If it cannot happen in the present or in the near future, When it happens, now we are suffering. We have no water to drink. You brought us from that. Though we are having slavery there, but we are having cucumbers and everything to eat. Now you brought here and only this tasteless food, because future they are not going to experience. But again, they had experienced a miracle, but still their hearts became hard. And that stamp put in the water, and sweet, bitter water turned to be sweet water. In other words, sweetness of God is being tasted there. But still people, but people become bitter with their life. As some of you become bitter with your vocation when you are misjudged, misunderstood, misinterpreted. But should not leave that hope. That is important. Now, God has promised that cannot take in the near future. Now, it will happen the end, God's own absolute future, that is eschatology born. Now, we go to the important with this beautiful background from this Kairoi, Kairos, and entered there, salvation history, secular history, human history, and now again salvation history and God's intervention. Now there are some concrete Old Testament eschatological expectations, basic categories of eschatology. So that heading, don't forget that. These are not only expectations but categories, because I always ask the question with the categories and people think that what is that. So in the process of drawing the picture of God's absolute future, Israel developed basic categories of eschatology. Namely, the promise, first one. The promise is a declaration announces the coming of a reality that does not yet exist. Jürgen Moltmann, he says that. What is the promise? It's a declaration. It's going to happen there. Till now, never happened there. So, I promise that tomorrow we'll have class or we may not have class. So, brothers say that better to have class.
Yes.
Because they can escape the work.
No, we love both.
One brother says, some of the students say, we love both. We love both, which is also correct. And we have another option than loving both and living with them. That was there. Okay, radical orientation to the future is important in the promise. Hello. In the promise, we need a radical orientation to the future that is going to happen. Now, David and Sion tradition, and then the Sinai covenant, this tradition, this has taken place there. The promise, first of all, I will give you a land, leave your place and go to the Ur, go to the place where I am going to show you, and there I will provide you everything. He went there and he doesn't know what to do, but he got it. And come to Mount Moriah and
sacrifice.
But there the Lord supplies that hotel, that one there. So this is a surprise. This is not only prayer of the Psalms, prayer of the Old Testament, and it happens in each one's prayer and each one's life. Only thing is, you have to be aware of that one there. Now, the promise of the land and progeny, it is being announced there. So development eschatology focuses on the Davidic line, that is Jerusalem. So a king is born. Now, Nathan's promise, 2 Samuel, 7th chapter. After me, 2 Samuel, that's a very beautiful quotation. It's actually, I used to say about this, a Christological quotation about the person of Christ. But it's a promise about person who is going to come there. Davidic line. And certain expectations, certain projections, peace and fertility. So, these are the promises there. And city of David was inviolable and originated there. Now here, this it was a city which, because of the presence of the deity, could not be defeated there. So many tried to conquer that, but they could not enter there. Now that is the promise, the first Old Testament expectation, 3.6.1. Now 3.6.2, that's the day of the Lord. This is a rather easy, especially in the Psalms we listen a lot, this one there. The widespread one, the widespread notion of the day of the Lord sinks its roots into distant memories of a particular days in history which God had shown the power of liberating the his people from their enemies. That's the day of Midian. So certain days are shown there, and God's intervention directly there, and people are experiencing there. And we have ample of quotations, especially in the book of Prophet Hosea 1:5, Lord Josiah 10:12-14. And these are things speaks about the day of the Lord, how it is related eschatologically is. Originally the idea day of the Lord stands relations with the institution of the holy war with reference to the conquest of the land. So tomorrow we are going to have war, they declare. And okay, march, go, Alpha, all of you get up and go like that. All will be marching for that. March and going according to that one there. Now with reference to the conquest of the holy land there. So in it, God himself takes part in the battle and musters the army. As it stands in the Bible, the notion belongs to the monarchic tradition. So God is going to fight, and that day is being instituted in your life. Now you focus, you go ahead. The day became therefore the day of year. Hello my dear brother, my dear students, it is not only a day of the Lord or meeting, it's a day of judgment. Day of the Lord, the day we are going to meet, that is after our death, judgment. On all those who stand in opposition to God, Israel is included. So if you are not accepting God's will here on earth, you have to face that, and there you will be judged there. So it is especially the prophets who are responsible for the significant development which to a large extent grows out of the Sinai covenant tradition. In other words, day of the Lord, meeting of the Lord, that is after the death and after your life here on earth there. 3.6.2.